Hello and welcome to The Big Picture. One of the long-felt demands of the industry and corporates in this country has been to bring about changes in the labor laws. The liberalization of these laws, it has been argued for years, is the key to increase in investments in the manufacturing and allied sector, and also more importantly, generation of new jobs by lakhs, if not millions, as required. The successive governments have, however, been cautious in bringing about major changes as demanded. Recently, the Rajasthan government has got a number of key amendments passed by its cabinet to key central laws like Industrial Disputes Act, Factories Act and Contract Labour Act. It's being heard that the new NDA government at the centre is also planning to liberalise labour laws, which would make retrenchments easier in the national investment and manufacturing zones. Other measures are also being envisaged. How will these changes help the manufacturing sector? How will it help improve the job creation scenario, which has been badly affected in the last several years? How key is the liberalizing of labor laws to growth in the manufacturing sector? And most importantly, will these liberalized laws promote better industrial climate in the country? We will discuss all this today with Tapan Sen, General Secretary CITU, Ajay Shankar, Member Secretary, National Manufacturing Competitiveness Council, Brijesh Upadhyay, Secretary, Bharatiya, Mazdoor, Sangh, and Santosh Mehrotra, Director General, National Labour Institute of Research. Welcome to all of you. Mr. Ajay Shankar, I would like to come to you first. This national, your council, the National Manufacturing Competitive Council, had come out with a paper earlier about, you know, how to improve the manufacturing scenario and all. How key is this liberalizing of the labour laws to improve the manufacturing sector?
I think reform in the labor laws and the ecosystem around labor in industrial relations is the key to creating manufacturing jobs. And this is an area which must get the highest priority if we are to succeed in getting rid of poverty. Now, one simple fact which I'd like to draw your attention to, that every Apple product we buy is made in China as job work by a Taiwanese company called Foxconn. And they employ 1.4 million workers. Now, the largest textile exporter or garment exporter does not have a single unit, more than 10 or 11,000 workers. So, India is paying a very heavy price for not creating the ecosystem for manufacturing jobs. If you look at the historical cusp at which we are, with a new government, with a new vigor and commitment to creation of jobs, and the global situation where analysts believe that about 100 million manufacturing jobs will move out of China into low-wage economies. The countries that are being talked about are Indonesia, Philippines, Thailand, Cambodia, even Myanmar, Bangladesh. But international analysts do not see these jobs coming to India as yet.
Why?
Because, as I said, the ecosystem, the regulatory framework is not seen as conducive to labor-intensive manufacturing. So this has to change if we are to get rid of poverty. Now, okay. How to change it is the key question on which we need a serious policy debate discussion, including how do we... I mean, in fact, our suggestion is that these 44 labor laws, or even more, because many states have labor laws, many of them written for the industrial situation in the late 19th and early 20th century. So why not repeal all of them and create a user-friendly, comprehensive legislation which is fully compliant with our ILO obligations? And in the present globalized economy, unless you are good with labor, the global, you know, market and supply chain will be uncomfortable. Right. We paid a very heavy price on the issue of child labor once upon a time. So it does not have to be an anti-labor law. It has to be friendly to labor, friendly to the entrepreneur, friendly to the industry. The regulatory burden is reduced. And we create an ecosystem where we create genuine partnership between labor and management and employers. Because unless we have a genuine partnership, we will not succeed.
Mr. Upadhyay, would you agree with what Mr. Shankar says? Do you think that One of the primary things, as he suggests, is to repeal all these 44 labor laws and bring in new laws which are in tune with whatever is necessary.
Actually, this drumbeat is just misdirecting the goal of the country. By simply amending the labor laws, actually, what should be our objective? What for we are going to amend these labor laws? First, we should try to understand, try to know which of the labor law is affecting the industrial growth, skill development of the industry, competitiveness of the industry. Means what we want to achieve by amending these labor laws. No labor law is creating hurdle in promoting the employment, in promoting the skill upgradation. Unnecessarily, it's an employer, it's an economist, it's a media, which are creating unnecessary propaganda, and it is misdirecting the country as a whole.
So you don't think that any repeal of laws or amendments or what is known as liberalizing these labor laws is necessary?
Repeal means the trade unions have also demanded to amend certain laws. We are not totally going to oppose it. We are ready to debate over this.
Right.
Which law is going to affect the... You see, unnecessarily, we trade union people are being considered as a hurdle creator of the growth of the industry.
Right.
It is not.
You are seen as the consider, biggest hurdles.
We consider if industry is there, then only worker can survive. We see survival of industry should be there. Because in that only worker can survive.
Absolutely.
So we are not going to oppose it.
And then the unions also can survive.
Yes, of course. We are for the welfare of the workers. If industry is there, then only that can be said. So we are not in this way opposing it should not be there. But unnecessarily, this blind race, we will not accept it.
Well, I'll come to what, to the specifics. Santosh, the fact of the matter is that in these last 10 years, the creation of jobs has been a major been a major casualty. We have seen in the UPA 1 also that it was virtually jobless growth. Even in UPA 2, more or less, we are talking of jobless growth. And of course, I know you will argue that there has been growth in jobs in construction sector and things like that. But we are talking of manufacturing sector. So is there a need now for some drastic changes?
Well, the talk of drastic changes is coming primarily because a new government is in place and the previous government did not take much action in this regard. And clearly both industry and the trade unions are agreed that the current state of labor laws demands some remedy. And there is also no question that having 50 odd central government laws plus on top of that another 50 odd state government laws is only confusing the situation. It's confusing both for labor as well as for industry, and therefore the idea, the point about the fixing the ecosystem is a very important one, and I'm sure there's no disagreement here. And I think the idea of simplification, I seriously doubt if any industry person or any trade union would actually disagree with that. Going about it is going to be hard, and clearly it has to be done in an atmosphere of mutual trust. And, talking about, labor laws as a source of a problem is not something that industry actually does, because if you do surveys of industry, and systematically surveys have demonstrated that they talk about labor law as only fourth or fifth in their list of problems. They speak about other things as major problems like
land,
water, electricity, you name it.
Yes.
Those are said to be much bigger problems. But that labor law, the current state of it and the confusion caused by the multiplicity is a problem.
Tapan, how would you look at it? See, I want to bring in what has happened very recently in Rajasthan, as I mentioned in my introduction also. Rajasthan has decided to amend certain labor laws. Three important central laws. Since it comes under the concurrent laws, the state government has decided to go ahead and amend these three acts, the Factories Act, the Industrial Disputes Act, and the Contract Labor Act. You think that is where we see a role model for what the center also may be looking at. We are also hearing about changes in the national investment and manufacturing zones act.
You see, I believe that it is quite amusing to note that as if the discussion is going on for the labor to create more job for labor, and the whole content of discussion is how you have a piece of chicken on your table, how do you go by it, whether a butter chicken or any other thing. It's really amusing. Labor law is being considered to be an hurdle to economic growth, job creation. This is a theory is being talked about since last three decades, again and again on every fora. But the fact is that this is not at all a fact. Even the ILO's employment report, not once, has clearly made their observation after a thorough study all over the world that the country having much more labor flexibility do not have any brighter performance in the job creation front either.
What about China?
This is Africa.
Tapan, Ajay Shankar was talking about China.
I think you should allow me to speak. You have just referred to China.
Yes.
A delegation from Indian Second Labour Commission, they visited China because China is often being exemplified by the Indian, either the industry, captains of the industry or from the government. They paid a visit to China, studied the industries there, came back and gave a report. Please go through that report. That committee, that delegation was comprising, that was a tripartite delegation, that is our employers organization, trade union organization and the government's representative. They went together, pay a visit and say, it is a story, it is a myth that in China anybody can be sacked anytime without anything. It is not like that. But your Rajasthan government is trying to bring that and they are no way innovative. Same model was tried. Jaswant Sinha, during the earlier NDA rule, in his budget speech, referred to that. It was tried and again, and it was simply, even to the tune, if that was implemented, say, from 100 to 300, employees establishing, they did not take any permission for retrenchment. It means more than 50% of the manufacturing unit in the country will be pushed out of that labor law and they can be retrenched at their will. The problem lies not in, the issue is not job creation. Issue presently, it is not in our country, all over the world, the whole system is in a crisis. And they want to wriggle out of that crisis by maximizing or minimizing the labor cost. And for minimization of labor cost, you must be more atrocious. Labor should be more, their rights should be totally pruned and they should be converted to slave. This is what is the game plan packaged, sugar-coated in various ways by so many intellectuals and every day played on the media.
Okay. Mr. Shankar, this is what it is.
And trade union movement will thoroughly opposed to that, tooth and nail to the up to their last blood.
Okay, Mr. Shankar, you have to respond to that. You're talking of an ecosystem and things like that. If the trade unions are not convinced by these moves, how are you going to improve the ecosystem to change anything?
I think there is a genuine apprehension.
Right.
That when there is a discussion of rationalization of labor laws or labor reforms,
A point he made. If you increase from 100 workers to 300 workers,
let me talk of the big picture.
50% of the manufacturing sector out of the Industrial Disputes Act.
Let me talk of the big picture. The big picture is a genuine apprehension that whenever there is talk of rationalizing labor laws or labor reforms, we are talking about inducting the American pink slip system.
Right.
Which is that you come, it was dramatically demonstrated when we had a problem in Jet Airways. These young people went and they were told, don't come today. Now, that model of industry...
It happened in Kingfisher, Jet
Airways. Now, that model of capitalism or industrialization has severe limitations as we are seeing over the last 5-6 years. And it is increasingly being talked about by the extraordinary inequality that has emerged in the US. The model we have to look at is the one which has worked well. What has worked well, success story is China, it is Japan, it is Germany. In fact, the Germany, they talk of a social market economy. So we have to look at global best practices, have a serious discussion that how do we reconcile or harmonize or create genuine partnership between labor, management and investors.
Right.
And we create the 100 million manufacturing jobs that the country needs. So we have to enter that debate with this objective in mind and see how we create genuine partnerships. Because clearly it cannot be anybody's case that we introduce the US pink slip system and succeed. But we also need to succeed and create 100 million manufacturing jobs. So that's the serious debate and discussion which we need in a very constructive manner.
Mr. Upadhyay, would you agree with that?
Is there any slip system here at all, Girish?
No.
Is there any slip system? Do they know that the 500 people in Maruti and around 2,000 contract workers in Maruti are just thrown out? Okay. Any slip? There is no slip at all.
Black
and the police and the police chowki, the police station people has gone to their house and told, don't come near the factory or don't lodge any complaint, you will be inside. The slip is different.
Tapan will talk of the larger issues, Mr. Upadhyay. How do we work out the system? Now here is a government in Rajasthan which has come out with this proposal and which would like to go ahead with it, because of course it's a concurrent list. The president's presidential assent is necessary with the same government in Delhi. That it is said that it won't be difficult for them. Now the Bharatiya Mazdoor Sangh, how does it look at what the Rajasthan government has done? Because that could become a role model for the center also to move ahead and bring about the same similar changes.
Rajasthan government has done very blunder. We are not going to appreciate it. Jointly, our central trade union, we are going to oppose it. And we have taken up this issue with the central even. As long labor laws are concerned, we are of the view first to discuss with us on merit. If really it is required, on certain cases we have already asked, yes, we are here to say, amend it, change it.
Which are these where you think that there is some kind of a consensus?
For MSMEs, we have asked them to have an umbrella law there.
Which one?
An umbrella law. A comprehensive law for medium and small scale industry. Okay. We have asked for them. And since beginning we are demanding to have amendment in the Bonus Act, in the Gratuity Act. There is a demand to define workers. In almost all the acts, workers definition is different. Because of that, many of workers are being denied for their benefits. So as certain cases are there, certain acts are there, certain issues are there, where trade unions are also demanding to get it amended.
Okay.
But going this way, making example of China, Tapanji has already, China is a myth. It is unnecessarily being projected here. Germany, whatever Germany has done, they have taken workers into confidence. France, they have not taken workers into confidence. Their result is different. So China, it cannot be.
What about Japan?
Japan is one. Germany, they have also taken workers into confidence. Wherever workers are being taken into confidence, together, workers and employer and government, wherever they are together, they can do it well.
Mr. Upadhyay, the question is, now that there is a new government here and that government is led by a party which is seen, I know you people will say that we have nothing to do with the BJP and things like that, but it's a fact that you're embryonically somehow connected to that. So do you think that it will be much easier for you people, since Bharatiya Mazdoor Sangh has now emerged as the largest trade union in this country? So is it going to be easier for you to deal with this new government, and do you see the possibilities of a better consensus is emerging?
You see, it's very clear. We have a policy to deal with the governments. Bharatiya Mazdoor Sangh, as a trade union, we have always said we will extend responsive cooperation whosoever is heading as a government. It may be of BJP, it may be of anyone party. As long government will respond in favor of workers, we will respond in favor of government. If he is going against the workers, we will like go against the government, whosoever is there. That is not the concern. Second thing, yes, we can approach this government and we are trying to say them, don't create this type of problems. If really you are interested for industrial growth to for creating more employment, more jobs, we are here to discuss with you, we are here to cooperate with you, but by ignoring working class, by using hire and fire policy, by adopting this method, we will not permit it.
This one of the things which has been, I'll come to you, Santosh, before that, one of the things which has been suggested by the Rajasthan government is to increase the representation to start a trade union from 15% of the total workers to 30%. Is this something?
That is wrong. We are demanding, we are not allowed, being allowed to register a trade union here.
Even and with 15%?
What, even in existing rules.
So
there is a direction not to register trade unions.
Santosh, you know, there are a lot of nitty-gritties involved in this, but the larger issue is that job creation. As you rightly pointed out, that, you know, it is said, a study says that 75% of the problem is not the labor laws, it is the other thing. So when Mr. Shankar talks about ecosystem, creating the ecosystem, where does the biggest problem lie in job creation?
There are several things, and labor law is only one of them. For instance, the Ministry of Micro, Small and Medium Enterprises has a system of incentivizing micro and small enterprises, which have investments of less than 5 crores. But the moment your capital investment rises beyond 5 crores, in other words, you might become medium-sized, all the incentives disappear. You fall off a cliff. Now, that's a very inappropriate.
So there is no incentive for you to grow.
Absolutely right. And if you cannot grow, then you cannot hire more people. So we need to strike a balance between creating new jobs on the one hand and maintaining the security of those who are existing workers. This is one big problem. A second big problem is that the majority of our workers, as we were saying earlier, are in the unorganized sector, which means that they are working in micro, tiny enterprises employing less than 10 workers. When 78% of your workers are in the what is called the unorganized sector, and I'm not talking about the fact that there has been a rise in the share of informal work in organized sector. While the share of organized sector enterprises has been rising, there it's been informal work, which is a problem. But labor law is a bit of a source of that. But let me come back to the fact that 78% of all enterprises are unorganized sector enterprises. There's practically no labor law in place there, and there is a problem. Hold on, I haven't finished. It's absolutely critical that these unorganized sector enterprises, which are mostly located in tiny towns, those tiny towns must receive much greater investment. Now, this new government is talking about building 100 new cities.
Right.
That's fine, but you know, building 100 new cities is going to cost a lot more money than putting money into brownfield sites where there are a large number of existing modern industry clusters, which are all in tiny towns, which are creating these so-called jobs, but all in the unorganized sector. If you created the infrastructure, the electricity, the roads, the water, etc., the infrastructure in these tiny towns, then the possibility of these micro enterprises to grow beyond being micro and into small and perhaps even medium and then creating the jobs would be possible. So labor law is only part of the problem. Labor law is one of the reasons why this missing middle still continues to exist. Small must be allowed to grow into middle.
Mr. Shankar, you know, one thing. The national manufacturing, it was in 2006, the national manufacturing policy was, adopted. And it was said that the decade from 2006 to 2015, 12 to 14% growth in manufacturing sector was what was envisaged. And what do we have now? 1.9%?
See, I come back to my opening comment that we have to have a constructive discussion to see how we create 100 million jobs. Now, he referred to the small and medium enterprises. The reason why the thought occurred of amalgamating 44 laws into one modern 21st century law was that when you are small and you grow big, suddenly you hit 44 laws. So many small enterprises choose not to become big or open a second Benami unit, a third Benami unit. In the same hall like this, there'll be five separate legal units. Now, it is possible to write a new law which retains the substance of all the protection for labor today, but in language which is friendly to labor, friendly to management, and fully compliant with ILO obligations. If we have a draft of that kind, we can begin a discussion on it. I'm not saying that it needs to be adopted.
Right.
But it's time the country had a serious debate and asked itself, why with such low wages, why with so much poverty, so much unemployment, global investors are looking at investing in every major country except in India for labor-intensive manufacturing. If you look at the last 20 years, even 2007-8, peak year we had 14 or 16% growth in manufacturing. But it was all technology-intensive, capital-intensive.
Right.
We are not creating large factories which make toys. 80% of our domestic toy market is with imports today.
Right.
Bangladesh exports more garments than we do. So we have to have a serious discussion in this country how to address this.
Tapan, you know, this is a, where does the trade unions and people like you, leaders in the of workers, because you also need to think and help the government also to create this kind of, you know, ecosystem what Mr. Shankar talks about. So what kind of consensus which you people will try to evolve with the government? Have discussions started with the new government on these issues?
Not yet. We are going to give a memorandum jointly along with Brijesh and others to the government on this matter. And on that matter, we will make it clear that this Rajasthan model is not acceptable to the central trade unions and the trade union movement as such, number one. Number two, I think in order to evolve a consensus, certain aspect need to be made clear. Is it a fact that but for labor law, the investment is not coming in our country?
That is a fundamental question, actually.
Just now, the gentleman told that more than 80% of workers are informal sector, even in the manufacturing segment of the economy.
Right, right.
That means no labor law is on them. There is absolute liberty for the employers. Then also, in the same segment, investment is just not increasing. Number three point is that today what is the status of existing labor laws? If you see the implementation status, they are more violated than observed.
Okay.
They are more violated, and this violation is being sponsored by the enforcement machinery. That caucus is already developed. And irrespective of who is in the government, no.
Right.
It is continuing since last three decades.
Very quickly.
Tapanda, can I ask you a question? Why are the violations happening? Aren't the violations sort of encouraged by the multiplicity of the laws? Because in some ways...
Not at all. And I think, why don't you put the question in that direction? Why a thief is stealing materials?
Okay. Tapan, we are running out of time.
Try to find the reason behind that?
Tapan, we are running out of time very quickly.
Instead of addressing the theft or thing, you are violating a law.
Okay.
In our country, the persons violating law must be behind the bar.
Okay.
But except for labor law, the more violator is more get a more invitation to have either breakfast or dinner with the Prime Minister.
Okay.
That's the culture going on since last three decades.
Okay.
Irrespective of whichever political party is in the
government. Okay, Tapan, Mr. Upadhyay, very quickly, last word to you.
1 minute, just a minute.
No,
labor law is a benchmark. Tapan. In any civilized society, that benchmark must be maintained.
Okay.
Today, just now, the 103rd session of the International Labour Conference is just concluded in Geneva. India is also a party.
Okay.
All Tapan, the three sides. And you know what is the important agenda there?
Tapan, we are carrying 1 minute. Time.
To carrying the...
1 minute.
To bring the informal sector to the formal economy.
Okay. I think on that
and
note,
we are discussing just the opposite way.
I can't give time to Mr. Upadhyay. We are completely run out of time. But I think we have generally got a sense of what it means if we have to bring about changes in the labor laws. We have seen the debate here, and I'm sure, as Mr. Shankar says, that there has to be a better ecosystem created, but that cannot happen without bringing in all the people who are concerned on the table and working out a consensus, which we will wait and see if the new government what the new government will do about it. Thanks to all my guests, Tapan Sinha, Ajay Shankar, Brijesh Upadhyay and Santosh Mehrotra. Please keep watching. We'll come back with another issue on the Big Picture same time tomorrow.